So these were her parents, and she, as I said, was a somewhat spoiled young lady who went to a very famous school, the most famous school in Petersburg at the time. This is the Deutsche Hauptschule zu St. Petri. It was a coeducational school, many famous people went there. Lou Andreas Salomé, for example, had been a student here. Edith Södergran went through high school to this school. It was divided into men on one side and women on the other side, but there was a lot of intermingling. Her French teacher, Henri Cottier, I think nobody would remember him if it wasn't for the fact that Edith Södergran had a crush on him and wrote some of her early schoolgirl poetry about him and for him in German. She actually has a book which is called the Exercise Book Poems, and they're sort of a young woman's attempts at poetry, some of them actually quite clever, and some of them directed with a little bit of an ironic sort of touch to Henri Cottier. She blames him for being cold and disdainful and for not understanding her feelings, a typical kind of high school girl story. But of course, also in that time, terrible things started happening in Petersburg. The so-called Bloody Sunday of 1905 was really the beginning of the big troubles that led eventually to the Russian revolutions in 1917, the March Revolution and eventually the October Revolution when the Bolsheviks took over, all of which she witnessed. And this is a painting from the Bloody Sunday, which I remember my grandmother actually talking about this indignantly, how people had come to St. Petersburg to demonstrate to the Tsar because they were hungry, basically, and that the Tsarist troops had fired on these unarmed people, and many, including women and children, were killed. Then, after her father had died of TB, Edith Södergran herself, and here is another picture of her in which she looks very different, contracted the same disease. And so she was 16 years old when she was diagnosed with TB. And so from the age of 16 to the age of 31, when she passed away, she was living under the shadow of that disease. And that is why in so much of her poetry, you can hear her talking about what I call in the title of my translations, the face of death, which is actually a line from one of her poems. She initially was sent to a sanatorium in Finland called Nummela, and she hated being there. She had a very, very hard time with the sort of discipline that was imposed on TB patients in Finland at that time, in sanatoria. She escaped from there. She was unruly. She climbed to the top of the building of the sanatorium and wouldn't come down. And I mean, she was generally kind of a problem patient. Finally, her mother and she decided that they would go to Switzerland to seek a cure for her. And they take off from Helsinki in 1910 on a steamer to Stockholm. And there is a book, in fact, in the Södergran archives where she describes this journey, and she describes it in English. Mm-hmm. It's a very charming little book where she kind of communicates her excitement about finally getting out of Finland and into the big world and the continent and so on. And another thing that's very lucky for her was that she was under the care of this man whose name was Ludwig van Moralt. and he was a TB specialist, but he was also someone who had trained under one of Freud's disciples, Eugen Bleuler. And so he had a kind of a psychiatric background as well, and had the capacity to understand someone like Södergran, who needed much more than purely a medical treatment. She was a budding poet. He sensed that, and he gave her that kind of support. She, of course, fell in love with him too, and actually he was married, and she used to take pictures of his wife and take very ugly pictures of his wife and would send them to him, sort of, look at your wife, kind of things. Performed something called an artificial pneumothorax on her, which involved inflating the lung and having it collapse. I am not quite sure exactly how that worked. But she was somewhat cured when the two ladies finally returned to the north. And when they returned, they had already, thanks to the revolution in Russia, lost most of their life savings that were placed in, of all things, Ukrainian and Russian stocks. I mean, not a good placement for your money in 1917, to say the least. So they had pretty much been wiped out financially. And they had to leave Petersburg and move to this village that I showed you on the Karelian Isthmus called Raivola. And it is in this little villa with the Greek Orthodox Church, Russian Orthodox Church in the background, that Edith Södergran lives out the rest of her life. She was an avid photographer. This is one of her compositions that she took of the environs of Raivola. This is the Onkamo Lake that she writes about, and the forest, which is mainly pine, but also a very famous large forest around that area, which, as you'll see, she writes about in her first collection, which we'll come to in a minute. In fact, this is the cover of the first collection. This is a first edition, which I'm happy to say that I own. And it was published in 1916. She had written to the publisher Holger Schildt in Borgo. Actually, the publishers themselves were in Helsinki. And asked if they would be interested in publishing a collection of poems. And Holger Schildt had turned to his cousin, Runar Schildt, who was a very well-known short story writer, novelist, actually who was a wonderful, wonderful writer. And Runar had looked at those poems and recommended publication. So she, but he also told her that she could not expect an honorarium because of the high price of paper and the fact that not many people are interested in poetry. So she said, never mind, please publish, and Dikter came out in 1916. This was a major, major happening in not only Finnish, but Scandinavian literature. Because until this time, most writers had been men, and most writers had been writing in a very formalistic style with rhyme and meter and a very sort of alluding to the classics and so on and so forth. And Södergran comes out with this slender volume, which is completely different, and she's someone who is, you know, coming from absolutely nowhere. And I'll read you the opening poem of Dikter. and a couple more, just talk about them a little bit to try to illustrate how different this was. The first poem in Dichter is called I Saw a Tree. I saw a tree that was taller than all the rest and laden with pine cones out of reach. I saw a great church with open doors, and all who came out were pale and strong and ready to die. I saw a woman, smiling and painted, throw dice for her fortune, and I saw that she lost. A circle was drawn around these things that no one can cross. Now this is sort of a, what they call a montage technique. It's several little pictures that add up to a bigger whole. I saw a tree, I saw a great church, I saw a woman. And then at the end, it has kind of a visionary quality to it, right? Mm-hmm. Which is very reminiscent of a direction in poetry at that time called symbolism. And the symbolists were, for example, in France, Baudelaire, Rimbaud, and Mallarmé. They were people who had rejected sort of writing about reality as reality and instead wanted something that was more dreamlike and a reaction really to realism.
So you read the last two or three lines again, which you lost.
A circle was drawn around these things that no one can cross. And that's very significant because she is basically saying that this is a narrow circle, her own life is circumscribed, and she feels that she can't get out of it. She felt enclosed and enclosed in. So it's a kind of a life review at the same time as it is a symbolist poem that can be read just like that. But as in many of Södergran's poems, it is also, you can also see a kind of a concrete reality behind this poem. I saw a tree that was taller than all the rest. There was in fact such a tree outside the Södergran villa. It was a huge, large tree full of pine cones. And there was a church with open doors that was the Russian Orthodox Church. People came out and pale and strong and ready to die. So this is very much in that symbolist tradition. And I'll read you another one which is so different and reflects another really strand in our poetry at the time, which was, I'll read it first and you'll see. It's called Vierge Moderne, so modern virgin. And here she says, I am no woman. I am a neuter. I am a child, a page boy, and a bold decision. I'm a laughing streak of scarlet sun. I'm a net for all voracious fish. I'm a toast to every woman's honor. I'm the whisper of desire in a man's ear. I'm the soul's shivering, the flesh's longing and denial. I'm an entry sign to new paradises. I am water, deep yet bold up to the knees. I'm fire and water, honestly combined on free terms. I skipped a few lines, but basically this is a catalog poem. And who does it remind you of in American literature? Whitman, exactly. I am, I sing myself, I'm this. She read Whitman in English. She was influenced by Whitman. So it's a series of statements about the speaker's identity. I'm this, I'm that. There is no dreamlike quality in this poem at all. And it ends on a statement that, I mean, today we would call, you know, gender equality, perhaps. I'm fire and water, honestly combined on free terms. Fire, water. it's very much at home in the fin de siècle discourse on the new woman, who was, as we all know, the flapper with short hair. She smoked, she wore pants, she was someone who called to action and open to new possibilities, including erotic possibilities. So then there's a third strand in Dicta that I'll briefly talk about. And this one is the nature poetry, the lyric, nature lyrics. And this one is called Autumn. It's a very short poem. The naked trees stand around our house and let in endless sky and air. The naked trees march down to the shore and mirror themselves in the water. A child still plays in the gray autumn smoke, and a girl walks with flowers in her hand, and at the edge of the sky, silver white birds fly up. This is sort of like an impressionistic sketch. It's like a painter who's looking around to find the motive that he or she's going to paint. It's a masterful, I think, miniature, and also reflects sort of the sense of alienation of the poet, kind of a little bit apart from the rest of the world. So she was well received with this collection. There were some very nice reviews, and others that were a little bit critical of the fact that she didn't write with rhyme and meter, but basically it was a favorable reception. That is not the case with the next collection, which was, you know, conceived in the turmoil of what now had become the Russian Revolution. People were in the street, there was no telling what the future was going to be, everything was uncertain, and Sidagran herself felt that at the end of the revolution, she felt, as she puts it, like a stronger hand has gripped my pen. And she then published what came to be sort of a scandalous, almost, collection called September Lyran, or the September Lyre. And it was one that was preceded by an introduction that became famous as a kind of a literary manifesto, and for which she was very much criticized. And it reads partly as follows. My poems are to be taken as careless sketches. As to the contents, I let my instinct build up what my intellect watchfully observes. My self-confidence comes from the fact that I have discovered my own dimensions. It is not for me to make myself smaller than I am. Now, any of you who know Scandinavians know that you're not supposed to stick your head up and say that you're great. Here is Södergran doing exactly the opposite. And critics just couldn't believe what they were reading, and especially coming from a woman. And there was a lot of debate in the press, you know, is Södergran crazy, or has she completely taken leave of her senses? And it led to a feud, really, in the press about her. And it was one of the most vicious literary feuds in Scandinavian letters. Yes?
Yeah, help me out with some paratext. So she's living in Finland.
She's living in Finland now.
So these feuds, they're all going on within Scandinavia?
They're going on in the Finland, Swedish and Swedish press mainly.
Okay, so we're not so much involved in revolutionary Russia.
We're not really involved in Russia anymore. We're living in Finland now.
And she's in that little country
and
house?
And she's in that little country village, yes.
And she's in her mid-20s?
Yes, she is, what would she be, 1918, she was born in 1892, so yeah, she is about 25, something like that.
Thank you.
And through this publication and the feud, and let me just remind you that these literary manifestos were quite common at that time. There were other people who were writing them too. There was Mayakovsky, there was a futurist in Italy whose name I'm forgetting at the moment, but this was sort of a literary convention in a sense to write these kinds of manifestos. So there was nothing new in that. But through this debate and this feud in the press, she came to meet someone who was going to prove to be very, very important in her life, and that was the literary critic and writer Hagar Olsson. Olsson was the same age as Södergran. She was about 25 when they met. She was pretty much the same sort of social background, interested in the same things, interested in what was going on the continent, multilingual herself. She was actually the one who almost single-handedly introduced new French and German literature into Scandinavia. So she was a very, very important person. And she writes to Södergran apropos this book and says, look, you know, I understand what you're trying to do, kind of, but, you know, did you have to do it in this way? And that starts a correspondence between these two women that has actually been published as Edith's Brev. And it has been translated into English too. It's a very, very moving correspondence that is really reflecting who she was and her circumstances at the time. And I would like to read you one letter that she writes to Olsson, trying to get her to come and visit. And she says to Hagar Olsson, she says, charming child, cannot come, sleeplessness, tuberculosis, no money. We live by selling furniture and household goods. Our money is placed in Ukrainian and Russian stocks. We will be saved if the Bolsheviks lose. How old are you? Health, nerves. I hope you're healthy and strong. Give me a short biography. Mrs. or Miss, degree. Me, live in Raivola, Petri Schülerin, TB at 16, Nummela, Davos, artificial pneumothorax, waiting for the discovery of a medicine for TB. That's her self-description. Nummela, Petri Schülerin. That was very important to her, to have been a Petri Schülerin. In the beginning, this was an intense friendship on both sides. There are aspects of it that have made people speculate whether they actually had a lesbian relationship. It's not been proven. It doesn't really matter. And gradually Södergran begins to complain that Olsson isn't writing to her frequently enough, that she isn't coming to visit frequently enough, and she has very little understanding for the fact that Olsson is living in a big city, she has a job, she has to travel, she has a lot to do. But maybe also in Olsson's case she was somewhat afraid of Södergran, in a sense, to get too close to her. That's reflected in the letters. And nevertheless, they did stay in touch for all those years. And when Södergran died in 1923, Orson happened to be on the continent traveling. She was in Italy, I think, and her death came in the news of her death came in the form of a telegram, which came as a total shock for Orson, from which he never really recovered. And she tried, Sarah Grant tried to sort of live her life through Hagar Olsson in a sense. She knew that Olsson, for example, was going to go to Stockholm to visit Ellen Key, who was one of the big feminists in all of Europe in a sense. And Sarah Grant tells Olsson what to ask of Ellen Key, kind of tried to live through her. And let me just read you a couple of poems from the September Lyre, and then we'll move on to the next collection. And this is probably, it's a very short one, probably one of the most famous poems that she wrote. It actually, in my translation, has made the rounds of the Washington DC subway system for a while, because they had the poems in the subways and you can read them as you take the subway from place to place. It's called On Foot I Had to Walk Through the Solar Systems. On foot I had to walk through the solar systems before I found the first thread of my red dress. Already I sense myself. Somewhere in space hangs my heart, sparks flying from it, shaking the air to other reckless hearts. There's a sense of ecstasy here, sense of someone searching for her identity, sort of a pilgrimage in search of other reckless hearts. And red, of course, in Södergran very much represents blood and fertility and life, living an active life. There is also a sort of a sense of hubris almost, like in this poem called Power, also a very short poem where clearly the influence here is Friedrich Nietzsche, who at that time really influenced her a lot. I am the commander. Where are those who follow me? Even the greatest shield bearers are dreamers. Can no one read the fierce force of rapture in my eyes? Can no one grasp the meaning of my soft words to kindred spirits? I follow no law. I am a law unto myself. I am the human who ceases. Pure Nietzsche. Then came the Rose Altar, where the influence of Nietzsche is even stronger, perhaps. And there is one poem here that is called Animalistic Hymn, which is really almost like her literary testament. I love this poem. I think it's a very strong one. Animalistic Hymn. The red sun rises without thought and treats everyone the same. We rejoice at the sun like children. There will come a day when our ashes will crumble. It does not matter when it is. Right now, the sun shines deep into our hearts, filling all with oblivion, strong as the forest, the winter, and the sea.